Well, there's a quote immediately comes to mind, and I thought this is actually the reason why, to the extent that the Lord blessed the ministry there, it's because of this. And this was the quote: "We never intended to build a big church. We always intended to be the church."
Welcome, everybody, to the Grow Leader Podcast, where we grow leaders that grow churches by helping them reach their full potential. My name is Matt, and I am so glad that you're with us today. Hey, don't forget that all of the information you're looking for about GrowLeader can be found by a quick visit over to growleader.com. There you'll find information about upcoming events like our one-day regional conferences. You can access free resources for your church, and you'll learn how to be a part of our monthly mentoring calls with PC. growleader.com is the place for all things GrowLeader, and we'd love to see you there. Now, before we get started, we want to say a big thank you to all of the partners that help make the GrowLeader podcast happen each and every month. First, we want to say a big thank you to the Wesleyan Investment Foundation. For over 80 years, WIF has been helping churches and church planners with their borrowing and their investing needs. Now, maybe you're a pastor out there and you're dreaming about a new opportunity, or you're at a place where you're ready to invest the resources you already have. We really think WIF can help you, and you can learn all about them at wifonline.com. We also want to say a big thank you to Great American Family. Now, look, I'm a parent. We have four kids. The worst feeling in the world is watching something with your family and then making that mad dash to the remote control because there is something inappropriate in the show. We can guarantee that if you tune into Great American Family, that is never, ever, ever going to happen. All of the content is family safe. You can learn all about how you can stream their content at greatamericanfamily.com. And finally, Compassion International. Compassion International, they're the OGs of all things helping people throughout the world. And we're going to tell you more about them in just a moment. But thank you to Compassion. You can learn more about Compassion at compassion.com. Now let's get started with the show. Welcome, everybody, to the Grow Leader Podcast, where we grow leaders that grow churches by helping them reach their full potential. PC,
here we go. As people are listening to this right now, we are right in the middle of the ARC conference. In fact, we were both here very late last night with thousands and thousands of pastors from across the nation and the world, and we were having the time of our lives, but we are revived to a rag. I'm a little tired today.
I found my personality at the bottom of a coffee cup this morning, so I'm ready to go. As we start off every Grow Leader podcast, you guys know you've heard this, and we talk about our partners, and we talk about Wesleyan Investment Foundation and Great American Family, and I always say a lot about compassion. I said less about compassion this time for a very, very good reason, because we're going to talk a lot about compassion today. So you want to introduce our guest?
I am so excited today because as our listeners know, that we bring to them relationships and partnerships that are meaningful to us. Right. So we would never bring someone or something to our churches that we don't personally know and love and personally use. And today, I mean, I told them they're kind of the gold standard of parachurch ministries that have done such a remarkable job. Today, we are so honored to have Jimmy Mellado.
There you go.
Come
That's
on. I wanted to pronounce it. Mellado. Some people say Mellado, but it's not right. It's Mellado.
That's it.
The president and CEO of Compassion International. My friend, I am so honored to have you here today on the Grow Leader podcast.
Man, it is a blast to be with you guys. Hung out with you guys last night. Yeah. And like, I'm really grateful we're even doing this thing this morning because y'all didn't have much sleep last night.
Well, you're a dear friend, and we love what Compassion does, but I want to set it up. I want people to know you before they know the organization, because you have an amazing story. So just kind of unpack your life story and your faith journey, and just tell people who you are.
Yeah, well, my name is actually, I mean, you said Jimmy, and that's correct, but the real name is actually Santiago Heriberto Mellado. That's like the real name.
Why does that sound so romantic when you guys talk like that? It's amazing. All right, go ahead.
So, and I was born in El Salvador and grew up in seven different countries. If you can believe this, my parents moved in their 64 years of marriage. They're still alive, 93 and 89.
That's awesome.
They moved 41 times.
Wow. Why?
So he was an engineer.
Okay.
So he went from project to project to project. I'm an engineer by training as well, by education. And I loved it. I loved going to somewhere there's nothing and then there's a powerhouse. They built dams and roads and irrigation systems, electrical distribution lines, and he happened to be building a powerhouse and a dam in the jungles of El Salvador. As a 33-year-old, he was in charge of building this thing.
Wow.
And I was born on his birthday.
Wow.
And we moved, and you would think that that would be really unstable for a kid's life, and there were four of us siblings. Our lives were unbelievably stable. And not because we were in the same place, because we weren't. We moved a lot. But we had the same Savior in all the places. I mean, my family was my first church.
Wow.
And Jesus was just a regular part of our experience growing up. So came to Christ at the earliest age, like 6 years old, and so did my siblings. And wherever we went, we were always involved in the life of the poor because of my mom. My mom grew up in poverty. She tells us, growing up, she would tell us, as a little girl, she was taught how to keep a dirt floor clean.
Wow.
And for her, that wasn't a paradox, to keep a dirt floor clean. And because of her, we were always involved in the life of the poor. Because of their faith in Jesus, we were always involved in the life of the church. So it was a mix of those two things, because when the church is working right, it's always serving the most marginalized, the forgotten, the
poor.
That's
exactly right. And you were also an athlete. I want you to tell that part of the story a little bit.
Officially, you're the first. You're the first former Olympian.
Oh, really?
Ever had on the Grow Leader podcast.
Yes, that's right.
Ever.
Yeah.
Neither one of us would count.
Yeah, it wouldn't be us.
So in 1972, I'm in elementary school in Managua, Nicaragua, and I was mesmerized by the Olympic Games. 1972, the Munich Games, and the drama of it all that happened in there. And I remember that was the first time as a little kid I saw what was going on. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to go to the Olympics someday? I'd love to go to the Olympics someday. So now they didn't have organized sports there. And so I started organizing sports at school. I'd do, hey, let's do long jump. And then high jump. We literally had a tree limb that was a high jump bar. No mats or anything.
That
we just
hilarious.
Jump over, land on the ground. But by the time I was in sixth grade, I was able to jump over my head as a little kid. And then from there, it just kept going on and on and on, eventually about 13 inches over my head. And I loved all the events. So it was quite natural for me to go into the decathlon. So I did the decathlon in 1988.
Amazing. That would be in Seoul.
In Seoul.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's actually where I got my call to serve the church. I went for an athletic experience of a lifetime, and I came home with a calling to serve the church. And the reason was, while I was in the Olympic Village 2 weeks before the actual competition, a pastor named Paul Yonggi Cho, pastors the world's largest church, he came and he just had a prayer meeting for athletes. Anybody that wanted to have prayer, and I'm, 5'8", 160 pounds, I'm giving up 4 inches and 40 pounds to the average decathlete. I said, I think I need a little prayer. So I go to this prayer meeting, and it was not many, out of 5,000 athletes, it was like 100 people in the room. And he invites us to his church. And we went to his church that, not the next Sunday, but the one after that. And I remember at the church, sitting there with 25,000 other Koreans in the auditorium and just worshiping Christ. I'd never seen anything like that before. And they talked about a church of 500,000 people. And I didn't have anything in my mind to fit that in. And they talked about seven services from sunup to sundown. I think it was 17 satellite churches at the time and closed circuit TV, all that. And then they invited us to a seminar that afternoon to find and to hear the story of what God did in South Korea. And my dad fought in the Korean War. And so he would tell us all about what it was like in Korea at the time of the war and to see where it was then and where it is now. A movement of Jesus through the church has a lot to explain as to why, what happened in that country. And so I did. I heard the story of the revival in South Korea. And I was, at that time, I couldn't write notes fast enough. And I just felt the sense of, oh, Lord, to be a part of a movement like that, to help church leaders, to help churches flourish and thrive and change their neighborhoods, their countries for you. I want to be a part of that. So that's when I felt called.
That is so amazing. So what did you do next with your life? How did you live out that calling?
Well, one of the things, just to back up, growing up a third culture kid in all these countries, I often laugh. I'm not a third culture kid. I'm like a 12 culture kid because we were always living in new places. And they always had us go to American schools. Spanish was my first language, but they would take us to American schools so that we would learn English and they were better schools. And wherever we were, the Americans always thought I was of that country. So if I was in Bolivia, they thought I was Bolivian. If we were in Nicaragua, they thought I was Nicaraguan. Well, I was never any of those things. But I remember as a kid always feeling like I was on the outside looking in.
Yeah.
I was never part of the in crowd. And we would visit the United States, and you just got to, you know, for a kid coming from outside the United States to the United States, this country looked perfect to me. I mean, and they'd take us to all the best places, like, you know, Disneyland, and take us to malls, and everything seemed so perfect. I wanted to come to the United States. I wanted to be American. I wanted to leave that world behind, because there was some difficulty growing up in these countries, too. We lived through two coups. We lived through the Sandinista-Contra, Iran-Contra thing, like we were there. My dad was this, you know, just 2 feet away from having a bullet go through him. Oh. He accidentally got caught in a crossfire. There was another time he was arrested by Manuel Noriega. Remember that guy in Panama?
Of course. Yeah.
3 days arrested, had no explanation, and then released after 3 days. So I was like, can't these countries get their act together? I want to go to the United States and be successful in a country where it seems to matter to be successful. So after the Olympics, that opened up all sorts of doors in the United States. First, the Harvard Business School. And then while I was there, I was asked to write a case study on a church, the Willow Creek Community Church. I did that. And then in 92, they invited me to help start up a church equipping ministry. Now, I'd been called in 88 in the Olympics to serve the church. So now I'm invited to leave the marketplace and in 92 helped start a church equipping ministry. Well, I thought, hey, this is perfect. This all fits. I'm in my calling. I'm serving the church and did that for over 20 years. But something happened 15 years ago that led me to compassion. At the time, the church was only running about 2% diversity, even though the community around it was way more diverse. And the pastor at the time wrote a book called Divided by Faith. And was bemoaning the fact that our church didn't reflect any diversity. We were 2% diversity. And he said, you know, we don't have diversity in our congregation, in our instrumentalists, our volunteers, vocalists, and we have no diversity among our executive leadership. And I'm sitting in the circle. And I'm going, oh, that's interesting. So I just slowly raised my hand and I said, hey, now y'all know. Y'all know my real name is Santiago Roberto Mellado, and I'm Hispanic, right? just checking. And everybody laughed. You know, I did too. But the person next to me said, kind of just pointed out and said, oh, but you don't count. And two things hit me really hard on the inside. The first thought was, I finally made it. I'm on the inside. I'm Caucasian. I'm American. I'm not Hispanic. And the second thought was more Holy Spirit haunting in a good way. And that was, and that's not you, at least not fully you. I ordained you to be born of your mom growing up in poverty. I ordained you to be in all those countries, connected to the poor, connected to the church for a reason. That was a grace I gave you for a reason. Why are you running away from that?
Yeah.
And so that led me down a path of embracing all of who I was, not just the American adult part.
Man, I really love that. So we want to get into the compassion story, but I have to ask, since you led a church equipping ministry or association for 20 years, and you studied one of the greatest churches to ever exist at Willow Creek, this is a church equipping ministry at Grow Leader, so you have to give
That's why I love what you guys
do. Well, you have to give us a few nuggets. I want to know about your case study and the paper you wrote on Willow Creek and what you've learned and what you observed over 20 years and just help some pastors, because the people who are listening right now are pastors, church leaders. In fact, a lot of staff get together and just listen to this podcast together. They take notes because it's content heavy. Normally, these podcasts, we come in every month and bring just, here's how you grow a great church. Tell us how you grow a great church. Tell us what you learned over the years of leading one of the greatest church equipping ministries. I mean, just give some nuggets, leadership lessons.
Well, there's a quote immediately comes to mind, and I thought this is actually the reason why, to the extent that the Lord blessed the ministry there, it's because of this. And this was the quote: we never intended to build a big church. We always intended to be the church. So
that's
the focus on
so good.
Being the church.
Talk about what is it, break that out. So that's a great principle. What does being the church really look like?
To me, it starts with Jesus. I mean, follow Jesus. We're apprenticing to Jesus. And then some are called to help equip others to be apprenticed to Jesus better over time. It's reflecting the fruit of the Spirit. It's growing Christ-like people in a faith community and being focused on that. The Great Commission, the Great Commandment, that's what we're all about. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every nation, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all that I tell you. So that is what it's about. And the size is like, that just happens.
That's the byproduct.
That's a byproduct.
Yeah.
But being the church first in you. If the church is not alive in you, you cannot help someone else enter into that. So we got to live what we preach. We got to live what we are wanting to extend to other people. So that reality of loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, it has to be authentic, true to the deepest level of your soul. And then there's someone else, and then there's someone else, and you extend it to someone else. It's just the kingdom of heaven growing.
Yeah.
One life, one soul at a time.
Yeah.
So I think being clear on the fact that who we're becoming in Christ, and this is probably for church leaders and for me, one of the most important things, who I'm becoming in Christ to me is the most important thing. Mm. You talk about doing for Christ, which is very important. Being in Christ is the most important thing. Sometimes we put doing in Christ as our God.
Right.
The stuff we do for him. And the more compelling the mission, and compassion's mission is very compelling, serving the poor. But even that isn't good enough to replace Jesus on the throne of my life.
Yeah, that's good.
So as long as I'm released from those results when I'm living and I'm becoming the person God wants me to become, and then the results, if they are not a mere fruit of who I'm becoming in Christ, they're of no value.
Oh, wow.
None. So that's why we don't intend to be the big church. We intend to be the church. Be the church first in you. Be the church with that next person you connect with. That really is it. It's not complicated, but we lose our way a lot.
Right, exactly. One of the things I love about you guys at Compassion and all of our partners, honestly, is that how local church, you know, church focused you really are. Because that's one of the misnomers of parachurch is that you're not a part of the church when you are actually a vibrant part of the church and deeply love it, deeply want to build it. We've got to talk about the Compassion story, how you became, you know, president of this great ministry, and you're the person you succeeded. Of course, is a hero of mine, and just would love to hear
and
this.
Mine.
Yeah, let's just tell that story for a minute.
So I met Wes 30 years ago, roughly, and we have been dear kindred spirit brothers in Christ to this day. He still works for Compassion part time, so to have him still around is just awesome. So I told you earlier that I needed to, what you don't count, remember we talked about that, and I started embracing all of my life, so I helped Willow Creek start the Hispanic Spanish ministry there, and then we started partnering with Compassion, and we started to extend our ministry into Latin America, and we partnered with Compassion. Wes and I were already friends, and Wes pulled me aside one meeting, and he said, you know, Jimmy, I don't get to be a part of the committee, I don't get to decide. I'm just telling you, in my quiet time, I'm beginning to sense that I think you're going to come after me. Again, I don't get to make that decision. I'm just telling you spiritually, I think you're going to come after me. And I said, well, Lord hadn't told me yet. And so we just started. He said, would you be open to pray about it? So I started to pray about it. And I can tell you now, looking back, it's been 10 years now, there is not a more congruent thing that I could be doing in my life than what I'm doing right now, and here's why. It unites the church of my upbringing with the church of my adulthood.
That's
and God
so
has called me. He's given me grace to be able to live in be a global citizen, go in and out of different cultures very easily. And it's very normal to me to go into the churches we serve in places around the world. I've loved going back to some of my churches, and some of them partner with Compassion. So that's been a beautiful thing. But the Lord also gave me relationships in the well-resourced world, you know, for the last, you know, 30-some right. years. And the Lord's calling me to help build a bridge between the under and the well-resourced world and to expand that bridge because it needs to be expanded. So what I'm doing now, yes, I was serving the church at Willow Creek all those years, But now the Lord has said, yeah, I want you to you know, equip the church, but now we're going to go back to the church of your youth. Let's equip the church there. And I remember telling Wes when he said, I think you're going to come after me. I said, now, Wes, you know, I'm a church guy. Like, I'm a church guy. And Wes goes, well,
then so
you don't,
are we.
Yeah, exactly. Then you don't know enough about compassion. It's not in spite of you being a church guy, I think we're interested in talking to you. It's because you're a church guy.
Right.
Because
I love
we're
that.
So local church committed at compassion. And you might think of us as a sponsorship organization. Most people do. And we do that. But we are, in essence, a church equipping ministry. That is what we do at the heart.
Okay, you have to define that, because let's assume there are some that are listening right now that have never heard of compassion, mm-hmm. and they did think it was just some child sponsorship sure. organization. Who are you?
Wow.
Talk about compassion.
Okay, the way I'll do it is tell you a story.
Okay.
About 25 years ago, brought a consultant in. They wanted to see compassion grow, and so they said, help us be able to reach more people. Because I saw that in 70 years of life, compassion for 56 years had slow marginal growth, but something happened right around there, and all of a sudden, growth just took off. We've like doubled in the last 10 years. The reach has just been tremendous as we've been on this curve. So I asked, what happened there? Because it predated me. What happened there that started that growth? And they'd tell me, they brought this consultant in, and they asked them, help us grow compassion. And that consultant came back and basically said this, tone the Jesus thing down. If you tone the Jesus thing down, you'll reach more people, because there's more people than there are Jesus following caring, more caring people
right.
than Jesus following caring people. So they were so offended by that. They sent the consultant on their way, and as they describe it to me, they doubled down on Jesus.
Well, come on.
And that's when the phrase, it was in that era that the phrase releasing children from poverty in Jesus' name was created. And I was talking to a leader that was in those meetings, and it was actually releasing children from poverty in Jesus' name in your face.
Yeah.
And so they kind of cut the last part out.
Yeah, yeah.
And then about 5 years ago, we made that the official global mission statement of compassion to reflect the reality.
And you told us a story before we started recording about someone in one of the centers in Ethiopia. You guys had you knew the vision stuck when?
Yeah. So there was a supporter I was talking to, and he's telling me his experience visiting the Child Development Center in the church in Ethiopia. And he saw this guy sweeping the floor, and he went up to him and said, hey, so what do you do around here? What's your role? And that guy said, I'm releasing children from poverty in Jesus' name. So when the guy sweeping the floor
that's
in
right.
Ethiopia
that's so right.
says that,
love it.
That's the mission statement. So that's who we are. So we thought, all right, if this ministry is going to be done in his name, we better do it in his way. What's his way? Discipleship. Discipleship. That is the way that Jesus invented this world would be redeemed and restored to him. So at that point, we said compassion is going to release children from poverty in Jesus' name, in his way, holistic child discipleship, doing two things. If there's anything that is providing an obstacle from that child or young person from realizing the full God-given potential, the program is going to help remove that obstacle. And second, if there's an opportunity that we can provide that child, that young person, an opportunity to help them move down the path of their God-given purpose in life, we're going to give them that opportunity. And that's what we do. We remove obstacles, we provide opportunities, holistic discipleship in the context of that local church. And that was the third thing. In his name, in his way, discipleship. Who did Jesus charge with discipleship? It was his church.
The church.
So that's when compassion decided to, if there was one thing that we would be good at, if there was one thing we'd be good at, it would be how to have a long-term, developmental, healthy relationship with an indigenous local church, a faith community in these poor neighborhoods. That would be the one thing we would be good at. And so compassion had to do a lot of pruning, because at that time, we did it in a number of different ways
right.
with different partners. So we, like for example, Mexico, all the ministry of compassion at that time, you know, 25 years ago, was done in partnership with local schools. And so they had to move all those local school partnerships to local church partnerships. And right now, we have 8,300 local church partners serving 2.3 million children, and that is the only way we do it. We equip the church to operate biblically, and when they operate biblically, what do? They serve the most marginalized
yeah.
children in poverty.
That's so, so good, man. And I appreciate that, by the way. I've been to Bolivia and seen the work of compassion firsthand, been in those churches, in those schools, in those villages, yeah. and it absolutely works. We're very, very passionate about it. If a church wanted to get involved like we are, and this is why I wanted to have you on the podcast, because, again, we always make available to our listeners, our friends, and our partners. And so if there are churches that would want to be involved like we are, what are their steps, and how can they be involved? Is it more than just writing a check? What can they actually do to be involved with compassion?
Well, I mean, you can personally sponsor a child. So that's always there. You can go yep. to compassion.com. But for churches, I love it. And I think this is where missions is heading in. I love it when churches start getting behind the local faith communities that are already there. And if there aren't faith communities in a particular part of a country or neighborhood, get behind helping plant a church there. Let's plant churches where there aren't any. And where there are churches, let's get behind them. Let's serve them. And that's what we try to do at Compassion, is to help be a bridge to help churches in the well-resourced environment begin to connect with churches in the under-resourced environment and join us in being that silent, quiet, servant leader partner to that indigenous group of faith leaders in that community. That's what we want to do. So just contact us, compassion.com. Give us a call. Go to the internet, find your contact information. We'll get you connected to someone that can help. Listen to where God is calling your church to serve, and then how can we come alongside what God is wanting to do in your church, and we can help you with opportunities around the world.
I love this so much, and I do want all of our listeners to at least go to the website, check it out, be a part of it. I think it would be something that we could highly recommend to you, and really I think it touches the heart of God. You've given us so many leadership lessons in this. I love the doubling down on Jesus, by the way. I think we're going to live in it. We are living in a generation that is going to have to make that choice in a variety of areas. Right. And the fear of losing, if you do double down, we're going to lose donors. We're going to lose. You won't lose. You're going to only gain. Right. So thank you for reminding us of that. But I also love the fact that you've combined something I've been saying for years, and that is that social justice has to have spiritual justice attached to it.
That's right.
So there's no spiritual justice without social justice. So we can't just say, well, here's Jesus. We don't want to help you, but here's Jesus. We can't do that. But also, it's equally as wrong to offer social justice and not give them the greatest gift.
That's right.
And the most important thing that they actually need, and that is salvation and the forgiveness of their sins. So the way I say it, and it's kind of a shocking way, I'd love to hear your reaction on this, but the way I say it to leaders is, you know, if we solve all of the poverty in the world, but they go to hell, we still lose.
That's right.
So we have to combine the two. We have to not just care for people and love people, but we're giving a cup of cold water in Jesus' name. We just have a couple of minutes left in the podcast. I want us to end with how you would end if you were telling your final story in a church, how you would give. When I was with Wes in Bolivia, he of course told us the details of compassion, but I'll never forget the kind of his closing moment when he grabbed our hearts and reminded us that this is what Jesus cares about as much as anything, and that is the poor, the hundreds of verses and commands for us to not neglect the poor. Give us that little closing moment right now for our listeners.
Let me put it into context. Today, in the countries where we are active, there are 170 million children that live on less than $3.20 a day. That's what it takes to qualify for Compassion's program. You got to live under $3.20 a day. We are honored to serve 2.3 million children, and that's 1.3% of the need.
Wow.
And today, we have a long line of churches that have already raised their hand. We know who they are. We know where they are. And they want to be a compassion partner church serving the poor. And we say no today 80% of the time.
Wow.
We can only say yes one out of every five times, or what we actually say is not yet. Because the church, the greater church around the world, when we tell them your need, they'll respond. And that's what I feel like my job is to really tell their story of what is going on. And I believe the church of God around the world will respond, and they are. So we can say yes, not one out of five times. How about we say yes five out of five times and partner with these churches? And let's be the church to each other and cross the gap between the well and the under-resourced world. So it to me is, an honor and a privilege to help build that bridge. And here's what's going to happen when we do. The lives of these individuals, you never know the ripple effect they're going to have downstream. There was this one little kid. He was in five siblings, and his mom and the siblings came home one day, and their father had been murdered. And he was in that little one-bedroom house, and they saw him, and they lived through the trauma of that. Now, you're an African mom, five kids, and you had no way to sustain yourself. That's when the church showed up, and compassion was in that neighborhood. That child got in the church, and that young man grew up, came to Christ, went to university through compassion, and now he leads a ministry that serves 15,000 pastors in Africa, a pastor discipleship network. He's the pastor now of the church he grew up in.
Oh, wow.
And he just started a Christian university in Uganda. This man will transform the world that he touches for the rest of his life. And that's one of 2.3 million that could be changed, and the 170 million whose lives can still be touched. We can do this together. There's the church alone can meet the need.
Yeah.
And I'm just, the only way I could make sense of going back and forth between the two worlds of under and well-resourced world is to be able to try to cast and the vision and tell the story of what God is doing in the Global South to help us link arms with what he is doing to see his purposes fulfilled.
It's amazing.
That's it.
That's it.
If you don't get it, you missed it. I mean, that's just it. That's what it's all about. Close this out, Matt.
Yeah, I'd say to pastors, hey, don't forget, giving's important. Where you're giving and how you're giving is even more important, though. And so we'll have resources on the Grow Leader site about compassion, and we'll have notes, show notes, where you'll know how to get in touch with them. Hey, Jimmy, thank you so much for being here.
Thank
with
you
us.
So much.
And thank you for being a partner with us, with Grow Leader, helping resource not only pastors in Uganda, which is just the craziest thing. We have to remember all the time, but resourcing pastors here in the States so we can grow the church, the capital C church. We appreciate you so much.
Amen to that.
Yeah, we'll see you next time on the Grow Leader Podcast.